Mark, let's talk about the investing environment in this climate of inflation and central banks. Most recently, we saw the Bank of Canada pause in September, waiting on the Federal Reserve south of the border. How should investors be thinking about all of these elements?
Well, thank you for having me, first of all. I'm delighted to be here. What I would say first and foremost is this is an incredibly, incredibly complex time for investors. I would argue even more complex than during the global financial crisis. And that's for two reasons. The first reason is the reason that you mentioned. We are in a higher for longer rate environment. Interest rates have moved up in as central banks respond to inflationary pressure. It seems that those rates, even though there's a the Bank of Canada has recently paused its rate increases, inflation is still out there, and inflation is a problem. And central banks are going to continue to monitor that and keep rates at a place, I think they've signaled quite clearly, that will tamp down that inflation, even if it's at a cost of economic growth. So that's the first thing. We are in a higher for longer rate environment. That causes changes to asset pricing. It causes changes to the way that corporations raise capital, borrow capital, utilize capital, and really reprices assets up and down the stack. And I think investors have to rethink their asset allocation. They have to rethink the way that they invest, and they have to rethink the way that they optimize their portfolio. So that's the first thing that makes it difficult, complicated, new, and arguably new, you know, in several decades, we haven't seen this type of environment. Secondly, and I think as importantly, is the geopolitical risk in the system. Really, since the Cold War, most of us haven't worried about big geopolitical shifts moving markets. But that has changed. We have a kinetic war, not a Cold War, a real war taking place in Europe. We're coming up on, you know, we're going to be into 2 years in to that, you know, horrible set of events taking place in Ukraine. We have geopolitical events affecting China. We have geopolitical events affecting the Middle East and other parts of the world. And I think this as well, you know, as an investor, you didn't have to be an expert in geopolitics until now. I think now you have to be, because it's going to affect your returns and your portfolios. You saw the recent cut that, or continued cut that Saudi Arabia and Russia have announced in terms of oil production. That's going to affect markets. That's going to affect portfolios. There's more and more of that really causing impact today.
There's a lot to unpack there. Let's talk about, you've mentioned markets a few times. How closely are markets watching all of this news?
I think markets are watching it closely, but I don't think that markets necessarily understand how to interpret it, particularly equity markets. We're in reasonably uncharted territory here today. We have great disequilibrium in global economies, in part due to those two factors that we just discussed. And I think that markets are going to be in this uncertain period of time as we have a shift from sort of the previous paradigm to the new paradigm, and how that reprices assets. And so for me, I would expect continued high volatility in markets, not just equity markets, but across markets for the foreseeable future.
Let's just go back and pick up on a few things that you had mentioned in terms of taking a look at different asset classes across the board, and I guess across different geographies. How should investors be thinking about their portfolios?
Well, let's talk about geographies for a minute. You know, diversification, it's being said, is the only free lunch in investing. And I've been a big proponent of diversification, right? Diversification should be able to deliver the same, if not a better return, with the same or lower risk. That's the benefit of diversification. And I've been talking about diversification, the benefits of it, for a long time. But today, again, you have to think about diversification a little bit differently. asset classes, pricing is moving and repricing due to higher interest rates. So, you know, maybe, you know, treasury bills are suddenly looking a little bit attractive on a relative value basis compared to where they've been for the last decade plus. In terms of geography, again, the world is changing. The BRICS, the so-called BRIC countries, as coined by Goldman Sachs about 20 years ago, Brazil, Russia, India, and China. If you look at the BRICS today, those great places of economic growth, it really is only India that remains as sort of an optimistic place to deploy capital. And, you know, North America is looking more and more as a place that's going to have comparative advantage because of our reliance on natural resources in Canada in particular, our high degree of skilled labor, human capital, in no small measure due to immigration and high education rates, natural resources, energy self-sufficiency. So all of those things are I think, making investors think, well, wait a second, as good as diversification is, maybe I have to think about it differently. And maybe the advantages to my domestic market are a little bit better now on a relative basis than they have been in quite some time.
Mark, are you suggesting that we, I guess by we, companies keep it here in Canada, in North America?
Well, I'm not necessarily suggesting that companies do that. Of course, there's a lot of reshoring taking place, a lot of companies moving production back to their home base. You've seen that with, in particular, in technology companies like Intel, which has moved much of its semiconductor production back to North America or to Europe. You've seen some of the automakers doing the same thing. So at some level, I think that companies are mitigating their risk by reshoring or friendshoring their operations. But it's a big world out there. And I think we have to, particularly in Canada, where we're a smaller market, continue to be global in our outlook in terms of our companies. We have to continue to look abroad. We have to continue to tap markets around the world and be outward looking. For investors, different question. I think for investors, in terms of where they're going to deploy capital, it may be now is the time to overweight your portfolio to domestic companies, including those companies that are operating ideally on a global scale. Those domestic companies are looking probably on a risk-adjusted basis better today than they have in a long time. And remember, investing, it's all relative. Right? It's all about the relative decision. If you're an investor and you have to deploy your capital somewhere, you're making a relative choice. Do I want to keep it, you know, under my mattress? Do I want to put it in a T-bill? Do I want to invest in equities? Do I want to invest in privates? Do I want to invest in real estate? It's all a relative decision in terms of where that capital is deployed. And so when I talk about our domestic market today, I'm talking about it looking on a relative basis more attractive than it has in a long time.
Mark, lastly, you had mentioned this this new world order that has been forming, but you've also mentioned diversification. And I heard you say that out of the BRICS, India is the most, I guess, most attractive when it comes to an investment partner, a trading partner. Who should Canada be looking to? What should Canada be exploring now when it comes to, I guess, trade, when it comes to investing partners?
Well, look, I think, you know, Canada should be diversifying, you know, our companies in particular globally. I just said that. But India is particularly attractive. And we have one, you know, great advantage in Canada that we're probably not paying enough attention to. And that is the Indian diaspora within our own midst in Canada. I mean, Canada has an incredibly vibrant community of first and second and third generation Indians who are connected, culturally connected from a business perspective, who understand how to do business there. That's an advantage for us. And I think Canada, for too long, has not taken advantage and understood that our multiculturalism is an unbelievable benefit to our economy in terms of creating that attachment, creating those business connections, and finding ways for our companies and indeed for our investors to invest around the world, because we have experts, whether it's language, culture, business practices, legal understanding, legal structures, sitting in our midst. We have Canadians who have that expertise right here at home, and I don't think we're taking advantage of them enough today. And India is probably top of my list for that example.